Oh, brilliant.
Hello and welcome back to Cinema Minutes. I'm Grant Robson.
And I'm Chris J. Allen.
This week we're talking about a fan favourite. We're going to be talking about Indiana Jones and Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Now, thank you to you for this one. We had a little poll on Twitter saying what retro review would you like to kick off a whole series that we intend to start doing, looking back at some of our favourite film franchises and stuff.
Yeah, I'm so glad we're starting with this one.
Yeah, it was touch and go. Alien almost had it for a couple of days. Jurassic Park was sneaking up there. But yeah, the Jones boys came and stole it at the last minute. So here we are with the first episode, looking at Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yes. Oh, what a great film. Where
what a great place to start. Yeah, any series, this is a
So this was released in 1981. It's 35 years ago now since it was released, and it doesn't seem to. It's held up the test of time. Amazingly.
We've both rewatched it within the last 24 hours now.
Last
literally.
6 hours, really. Yeah.
Watching that, we're not. But it holds up so well. It's been a couple of years since I've last saw this one.
Yeah,
a
long time for me
again.
As well.
When did you first see it?
I must have been about 8 or 9 years old, and I think that's probably one of the reasons it stands out so much for us, as it probably shaped my reasoning for enjoying film so much. As a technical exercise, that film is flawless. All of the shots, all of the lighting, everything in it is absolutely beautiful. And I think that was what really interested about it the most. So then when you start looking into the background of that kind of thing, you realise how much effort and how much the scale of everything that went into this film. Like so many other films, but in the same way as Star Wars, it's kind of like made this the blockbuster film, that kind of blockbuster.
These are, you know, interestingly mentioned Star Wars there, you know, those two are the real template for so much that has came after it. Similar story for me, I suppose, like, you know, I can remember being in the Star Wars already when I was a kid, but having...
Were you not born interested in Star Wars?
You may have felt like that in the theater that way when I was a kid. But I guess I remember having... you know, kind of my uncle's version taped off the TV, like in my nana's house sort of thing, of this one with, you know, handwritten along beside Raiders of the Lost Ark, taped off, you know, BBC One on Christmas Day or something like that. And yeah, that's, you know, it's always had that lasting impression since, like, you know, not just how amazing it is, but, you know, for me too, it was one that kind of really did spark that interest of, like, how is this thing so well put together and so fascinating.
Exactly.
Interesting in that case, but it does harken back so much to those, you know, sort of 30s and 40s Saturday morning serial sort of styles.
Which is a lot where the idea comes from, essentially, as well. This idea of an archaeologist. Well, he's an archaeologist professor by day and a tomb raider by night, essentially.
But... again, you know, as much as it's got us into film, is it part of the reason why I got into teaching as well? I think there may be some connection on a personal level. I've never had anyone doing the, like, winking, like, love you eyes thing to us.
This time.
I was in the start of a film when the whole class is sort of, like, probably captivated by what you're saying. I don't know if I've ever had that effect. I'm working on it. I'll get my guys.
Where do you start? So we'll start. The opening sequence for me is absolutely brilliant. So you don't see any of Harrison Ford's face. This whole little trek through the jungle. There's people looking at maps. And there's guides. There's things like that. But then the reveal is one of the guides tries to shoot him in the back, and he whips the gun out of his hand, and then you see Indy's face and the lovely shadow across him, and like you're first introduced to Harrison Ford as the character. It's just absolutely amazing. I love the... it's really dark and ominous, which the other indie films in the franchise don't really seem to have.
I guess they kind of go up and down, but I guess that whole opening scene, from what you're talking about, from, you know, the opening and credits, up till sort of when he kind of escapes on the plane, back it encapsulates so much about what the whole series is all about. You know, it's the sort of premise, and there is that little bit of mystery, as you're saying, you know, the actual adventure part, you know, the sort of figuring it out as he's going through the temple and stuff to then, you know, the moment with the idol, the switch over. But, you know, then it turns into, like, a comedy beats as well. Yeah. And, like, you know, the big action beat is he's trying to escape. You know, it's, again, become, like, the villain, obviously, Belloc, when he comes outside. You know, then kind of being chased away too. You know, it's all about it. And then, you know, getting into the plane, like, oh, got a snake sort of thing. You know, it's within that opening maybe 5 minutes, you know, it does everything that Indiana Jones does in all four films, kind of encapsulated and perfectly in that one sequence.
Yeah, I totally agree.
So the opening scene, obviously an iconic one. What other scenes stand out to you?
with this, with the whole adventure bit at the beginning, I love the transition from this like Tomb Raider to a like a tenured professor, yeah, essentially. Yeah, he's really, really smart, really well dressed, and he knows his stuff. So it's from that first initial point, you know straight away that he's a man of intelligence. Mm. He's got a bit of action about him. He knows what he's doing. I just really, really, I cannot say enough about the character of Indiana Jones. It's it's my favourite out of any franchise or any comic book I've ever read. Indiana Jones is the one that I aspired to be as a kid.
That's it. You kind of, you again, much like I was saying about opening scene, you see the whole span of the films.
Yeah.
You also see the whole span of the character. You know, you do get exactly that, like, the hero, the adventurer, yeah, but also the sort of intellectual, the
problem
again,
solver,
the sort of,
yeah,
yeah, but also the sort of like his comic side. You know, you do get that whole yeah, like gambit of it. It's interesting that you bring up those like initial scenes with the government agents in the school, yeah, and even the sort of scene following with when Brody comes to his house,
yeah,
and stuff
Brody's
like that.
An interesting one. This
yeah, serious Brody before before in a couple of films time when we get to ridiculous Brody, which is fine too. But yeah, it's you know, like
he's really serious.
This is
this
like
one,
when he can actually do his job, I suppose. It's kind of a Bond formula, though. You know what I mean? Like, you start off with a bit of like a bit of adventure and stuff, a bit of action, and then you kind of get the mission. You know, you kind of get told that he gets his.
And then
like,
there's the kind of in between bit where they're discussing the mission and like the
you know, like literally here's the plot of the film, and he literally kind of writes out the show code and stuff here. But it's done so well here, and again, you know, it becomes cliche because so many films have used this template after it, but you know, this is
the
again
archetype.
Much like we're talking about with Star Wars, this is kind of what sets it.
Yeah.
You know, sets the reason so many do this is because it works so flawlessly here.
Yeah, it really does. I read a bit about that actual scene with Brody in, and the word exactly like you say with the bomb formula. There was a scene where a girl runs across in that shot.
Yeah, so I guess that's why he's wearing his like
just
wearing his robe and stuff like that. It's like
very Hugh Hefner.
It's like almost Roger Moore's hair, I suppose. Like you know, like but yeah, I think it's better to cut it out cause again. Same. Like you know, it lessens the relationship with Marion, I suppose, especially in this one. But going forward, what other we've talked about? India, we've talked about.
Yeah, I want to get away from
jump out to you, I suppose.
A character, as I'll talk about in a bit, but some of the background stuff as well is really amazing about this film as well. So it was made on a budget of like 20 million. Did you see how much?
I think
that?
Adjusted for inflation, I guess about 60 million. But yeah, we're absolutely right. We were talking about this before we started filming, actually. And you know, this film looks epic. Again, watching it back, you know, last week we did our Avengers, Captain America roundup and stuff. Obviously, a massive film, you know. Upwards of 200 million now. This film looks as big. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's the place, you know, in those scenes in Egypt, especially just the hundreds of extras. You know, it's action scenes kind of wall to wall in this film as well. You know, it's just, it feels massive. Again, you know, it's interesting that it's harkening back to that B movie or sort of Saturday morning serial sort of formula in what it's doing, and you know, just the sheer action adventure sort of style of it. But you know, it's done on such a like luscious, huge scale where it really respects that. You know, it's not doing it how they would have been actually done in the
30s. It's not parodies.
Where it's like yeah, it's not
upon.
Like cheap and cheerful, like you know, and like or making a joke out of it.
Absolutely.
You know, it's within the universe of creative, they're taking it absolutely seriously, and again, that's why it holds up so well because it is genuine, and you know, that means that goes for everything. You know, it feels genuine when in Egypt or in the Nazi submarine or whatever it may be. You know, all the bits hold up so
really
well.
More about the cast and the crew that went into this. So, like, you're talking about a really young Steven Spielberg. You're talking about George Lucas just
after
Star
Wars again,
success.
You know, this, I think the writing process had obviously been going on some time back between, you know, between Spielberg and Lucas. But yeah, Lucas coming straight off
Empire Strikes Back,
they started making this one. Spielberg coming off the back of Close Encounters. Yeah. So, you know, following on from even Star Wars for George and, you know, Jaws for Steven Spielberg,
such a high
two of the biggest directors on the highest pedal. So they still couldn't get this film made, I suppose, you know, for quite a few years till it got to this point.
No studio would touch it as well.
But I mean, it's that's the thing, again, much like the case was for Star Wars, you know, if these guys come with you an idea, especially in the mid-70s, you know, you should have, like, bitten my hand off the paper because it's such a success story both times.
Yeah.
But it's so, again, everything about it just is all that enthusiasm for that sort of material that they obviously brought as well.
It is. For me in this film as well, one of the few films I can think of where music takes such a strong hold of you.
John Williams, yeah, of course.
Fantastic. Yeah, yeah. So the, the whole way through, I don't think there's a single scene in that film without a beautiful little score to it. The whole way through the film as well, and it's really ominous, and but it builds you up as well at the same time, and you're literally on the edge of your seat just from the sounds. And I really love that. It's probably one of his favourite John Williams pieces.
That's it. Again, obviously a composer with so much to choose from, but his Indiana Jones work definitely ranks so highly among
it. Absolutely.
Can we get producer Frank Marshall again, who would go on to continue his work with Spielberg too. Kathleen Kennedy, who obviously now head of LucasFilm, is one of her first credits assistant. Steven Spielberg too. Amazing. So again, you know, everyone behind it. Lawrence Kasdan, obviously writing the screenplay for this one. This summer, this just gone, obviously did Force Awakens too. So, you know, he's kind of, he's so many other big names and stuff that are going to have massive repercussions on the film industry from then on, and, you know, in the best possible way.
Yeah, emperors of the film industry from that point.
The big names. So,
we should say something about Douglas Slocum as well. He died this year, very sad news. He was the director of photography on all the Indiana Jones films, except for the last one. And what a job. What a job he did. So very sad news, but he's left a very lasting legacy. He had so many films in the 40s and 50s when I started looking, and I was amazed by like the catalogue of work that he'd actually had. But Indiana Jones has got to be his best pieces as well.
That's it. Again, it's, you know, as much as it's all those new talents starting too, it was also an accumulation of those people who went before as well, which is such an interesting thing in such a golden period, especially in some of those films of the 70s and stuff.
We were born 20 years too late, I think.
I'd say, yeah. But I guess for a good thing, I guess we get to revel in it now talk about it on the internet too, I suppose. We mentioned action scenes there. What other what other action pieces that stand out to you in this one?
The big one's got to be the airplane fight.
Pat Roach.
What a fantastic fight scene that is. I think there was a couple of injuries on there from both of them as well, actually. On the set.
It's a pretty brutal, like, you know, just
really
punching mat sort of thing, that one.
I love the punch noises as well. That's got to be some of my favourite fight noises.
Ben Burt, sound effect designer, miss. Money earned, obviously.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's such a great one too. Yeah. It makes me want to go back to Disney. Like, Disney have this stunt show where they basically recreate that on a stage sort of thing. And so it's like, oh, can I afford to go to do I get a credit card now just so I can go back and see this? So good. But yeah, amazing fight scene. One of the things when I was rewatching it again, it's how, like, we're talking about how this is, you know, such a template for blockbusters going forward. Yeah. And obviously now it is technically owned by Disney too. But how brutal this film is as well in some of the moments too. It's always, you know, sort of jarring in a way to see that, you know, like Nazi swastikas and stuff banded all over the place. Always, but obviously in the context of the film, that makes sense. But it's kind of like, oh God, look at, you know, these are like genuine, you know, sort of, like, you know, a genuine sort of threat and stuff. But, you know, Indy doesn't hold back either, you know, like, literally shooting people in the face in this film.
In the face,
you know, punches the mechanic from that fight scene, you know, into the propellers of the plane and stuff like that. You know, knocking people when in the truck chase and a little bit later, too.
Yeah, throwing
you
them know,
like,
the car.
Knocking people, like, off the edge of a cliff and stuff like that. And it's
that
like,
stunt man, that he nearly goes under the wheels. I told him on the side of the door. Money well spent on him. Like, really
That's
good.
It. It's, you know, it's an interesting time where, like, this is our hero. And, you know, despite him doing all this dubious stuff, and, you know, again, to mention things we've talked about recently, you know, like, people complaining about how Batman isn't necessarily the character of Batman because of how he
cruel
kills people and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting that obviously a film set in the mid-30s, like, Indy don't hold back, I suppose, you know what I mean? Like, some of these people get
really murdered, there's like the Sherpa scene as well when they're in the Himalayas. Some horrible deaths there as well.
I was going to say, literally.
But still the comedy value, like, just got that stick with the fire on top, and then he's just about to kill Indy, and, like, hits him on the head.
And that's it. And that's this film. It marries those things so well again. Yeah. In every scene, you know, people complain about, and we'll get onto it when we get to this film, but in the fourth Indiana Jones, the most recent Kingdom of Crystal Skull, people talk about the comedy moments and stuff like that, you know, being, taking you out of it. But I think people forget how funny this film is as well.
Totally,
you know,
agree.
Stuff like that. Even just like little throwaway lines
little
here
lines,
and there.
Yeah. It's not the years, it's the mileage.
Like, ones which have become classic, but they work so well.
Really
for people complaining about the sort of like gophers and stuff in the fourth Indiana Jones, but literally, in, you know, people are putting this film on such a pedestal. The monkey definitely does do a Nazi salute. It's like, you've got to, you know, this film doesn't take itself too seriously, but, you know, I suppose for its fat side of it as well.
Yeah.
Frank Welker, a great voice artist, doing the voice of the monkey bit. Cheap.
He's got quite a few monkeys,
like you know. I was going to say, you go to Frank Welker if you need a monkey.
Yep,
Frank
Welker. That's your man.
I don't know if that, you know, if he wants that on a business card, feel free, Frank. It's yours.
Yeah, the comedy moments, I don't think there's too jarring in this film, but that's the main thing I noticed about this film was how dark it was.
Mm.
And we're talking about how it doesn't take itself too seriously, but it's still kind of a serious subject, like fighting the Nazis, like preventing World War II, which ends
well,
up.
That's it. It's kind of it's the interesting thing about this whole series. I think it is grounded, and it defies its genres because of that as well. You know, I think as much as we're saying again, as it's a template, it's not afraid to go into comedy, but it does its action seriously too. It does horror and takes it seriously again. The scene at the end, you know, like heads exploding, faces melting, and whatever.
Yeah.
You know, again, like, literally does define genre and goes between all these things. There's so many people trying to recreate it since, but perhaps being too strict to those genre. You know, it'll be an action film, or it'll be this sort of film, or it'll be sort of a comedy. And, you know, I think it's just that freedom to happily
have
weave between all of
the
genres, which, you know, has brought Spielberg and Lucas so much success again with Indiana Jones and Star Wars. And, you know, modern day directors such as,
J.J.,
you know, James Gunn does that really well in Guardians of the Galaxy, merging sci-fi and superhero and comic moments and stuff like that.
I
think it's, you know, having that freedom is really such a benefit to it.
That's where, the like, George Lucas and Steven Spielberg stand out from so many other directors, because they have that creative imagination where they can kind of lend a lot of different ideas and a lot of different themes. And blend together so well. The point in this film for me that keeps us watching it is how it goes from that serious idea to kind of the mystical and the magical, and turns it on its head, because you think it's just they're just after these little tablets that are in, but it ends up being like a conduit to God, essentially.
Like, there is a big element of that sort of
supernatural,
And that works really well again, you know, as we're talking about it being grounded in reality. It's not afraid to go and genuinely sort of approach that sort of religious sort of element,
and
you know, supernatural element.
For the time it was out as well.
That's it. Again, so much of this film holds up so well as well. Yeah. Obviously, you know, I'm on the back of Star Wars and on the back of Empire Strikes Back. But, you know, but like, so
like the mannequins coming out, like the dolls and the skulls when they open the.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, it's fascinating. It's so clever. You can check out on the making of documentaries and featurettes how they did that. But, you know, it's still holds up. Again, I think, as you were saying, sort of, you know, the dolls and stuff, like, with the dressings over them and stuff. So it's a really interesting process how they went about it. But again, like, 35
years
later,
your
math is quicker than mine. 30. It still holds up so well. But yeah, we've got what about Marion? What about our romantic lead?
Marion Ravenwood, probably the only returning character apart from Indiana Jones.
Salah, we get back as well. We get Salah, do the crossover, but Marion, most notably in Indiana Jones 4.
One of the very few characters from that year I can think of as a really good feminine lead. Really strong, like, she's kind of tough. She knows how to drink. She drinks that big guy under the table. There's not many female characters or leads that kind of epitomised, like, womanhood.
That's it. I mean, this character, again, the reason this film holds up so well, and, you know, we're saying about that Bond formula and the things that we can look back on some of those 60s and 70s Bond films now and sort of, like, cringe a bit about the sort of way females are portrayed. But, like, this film doesn't do that at all. It's not so much the case in Temple of Doom, which we'll get to. But, you know, in this film, Marion, you know, we're introduced to a literally drinking in the bar, and, you know, that guy sort of toppling over again. Such a great comic moment. But, you know, like, she literally holds her own. She holds her own in the fights. She holds her own against
She gives
Bella.
India a good job as well.
Yeah, that's the thing. She, like, holds her own against our hero and stuff like that too. You know, against Belloc in the desert and stuff like that.
Drinks him under the table. She's a good drinker.
Yeah, that's it. You know, such a great character. Again, Karen
Allen really
is so good. But, like,
are you related?
I was gonna say, I think it's Ian. I think hers is Ian.
Oh,
Ian.
Man,
what could have been? What could have been? But
you could have been Mud.
I could have been Mutt Williams. If I was in the 30s, I would have to be 7 years. Oh, masters, as we've proved in this episode already, the masters.
Time matters little.
But yeah, what about our villains? And we mentioned Bella.
Oh yeah, absolutely brilliant. I can't remember if he's Gestapo Tot.
Is it just Herr Tot? Yeah, Herr Tot.
The guy who's actually been sent to task and find these relics so they can find the Ark of the Covenant. Mm. He's really scary, isn't he? I think he's only got 14 English lines in the whole film. And in them four, he really scares you.
He's such a like interesting presence. He just like looks so out of place in so much of it as well. But like that's kind of, you don't feel taken out of it in it as well. Again, like even in the desert scene towards the end when he's, you know, all the soldiers are marching and he's wearing his full black leather, you know, then you see him sweating and wiping his brow. Yeah, yeah. Like he just kind of like cuts such a mad figure in it, and you know just how menacing he is even in that scene we're talking about with Belloc, where you know he gets out the metal, the sort of tube thing like that from his guard, and it turns out to be the coat hanger and stuff like that. It looks like some, you know, bizarre torture device and stuff like that. A joke from 1941 again to your big fans. But you know, it's just like he's such a great character. Again, you know, so over the top in that, like that scene in this film, or you know, there's no shades of grey, you know, it's kind of they are bad guys, you know what I mean, and you know that to sort of comic effect to some some elements, you know, as much as we're saying they're a threat, you know, they're very much bad guys doing bad things,
like stormtroopers,
literally. But you know, it works again in an action adventure film. It works so well.
I think the interesting thing about Belloc is he's just like a classic cliche of like a 1940s bad guy from a serial. He's all in black. He's all like shaded and ominous.
Mention Belloc, I think he is like a really interesting villain as well. You know, sort of being the main villain.
He's like
the
opposite of Indy.
As Indy easily mentions, you know, he's Indy, but a shade removed sort of thing. You know, this is what Indy could be. Because, you know, he does have the same sort of profession, the same sort of interest. He knows how to push Indy's buttons. That scene at the end when Indy's got the sort of bazooka. And, you know, like, Belloc talks him down from it because he's like, he has the same feeling about it.
Yeah.
Really, and again, it's such an interesting character. This, you know, French sort of, again, sort of professor, you know, academic. Against the sort of harshness of the Nazi, the German characters that are represented in it. Just a really interesting dynamic.
I think he's very silver-tongued as well. I really like how he is portrayed throughout the whole thing. He's got his fingers in all the pies. He knows how to move the pawns around, sort of thing. So he's playing the Nazis off against, like, to find it, but they're just funding him finding this and getting the fortune and glory.
And then, up till the end scene, you know, when he's in his full regalia.
Where he pulled that from?
There must have been some of the Nazis carrying, like, interest in, like, you know, obviously the ones carrying the Ark, but some guys must have had, like, here's his costume. Like, you know, the wardrobe department of the Nazis, that's something they don't talk about nearly enough.
No, not at all. It doesn't come up. He just turns up in this, like, amazing, like,
he would ask questions,
that's what you need to
Such a great scene, though, that final. Yeah, you know, really jump ahead slightly. What do you... Again, something that holds up, as we mentioned, well.
Brilliant. Special effects-wise, this is the one that really got me. And when the head explodes, when Belloc's head actually explodes, it boggled my mind when I was little how they did that, and I was like, wow, that's so amazing. But as we were saying again about the ghosts, like, sweeping through everybody,
looks great, still looks fantastic, still really effective as well.
I mean, like, weaving through all of the soldiers and things like that, I still don't understand how they did all of that.
Yeah, I think part of the interesting thing about how it doesn't look dated is you find a lot, actually, with it being set in the past anyway, you know, being set however many, you know, set in the 30s when it was made in the 80s. You know, it's interesting how it doesn't instantly become dated. And again, even maybe the special effects don't look as out of place because they're in a, like, different sort of context.
Yeah,
end scene, but such a good finale.
Really good.
You know, there's that sort of thing going around on the internet as well, like, how much does Indy actually have any influence on this film too? But, you know, I think that's kind of, like, a mute argument, just out of, like, it's, you know, it's how he drives the film. It's not the sort of the end goal.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's the drive, not the destination, I suppose.
I think that's a really good point, actually. He doesn't get the fortune and glory at the end. Like, the American government take it away from him. He learns a lesson there.
It's an interesting, downbeat sort of note. But yeah, a funny one that again comes back in that fourth film. You know, the sort of the warehouse and stuff like that too. But yeah, so much to enjoy. Again, side characters, we've got Salah this one too.
Yeah, Salah's
such a good character.
He is, yeah, really good.
Just uplifting when he's on screen and singing.
He's kind of not like a comedy character. He's like really integral to helping Indiana Jones find like the city of Tanis and things. He's on the dig and stuff like that, but he's kind of got the British accent and he's really like jovial and jolly and he always keeps like an upbeat. I love the bit where he catches the date.
The date, bad dates. love it, but yeah. Final thoughts, what are some big moments from this film for you? What's your, top couple of moments maybe?
The purple moment is definitely the bit where they're running out of the temple and he gets chased by the boulder. God knows how many times Harrison Ford had to do that shot because it's like cut. That one for me, from thinking about how they did it, it's probably the most interesting bit of that.
I was gonna say iconic as well. Just so you know how much that boulder chase scene from the start has remained such a big part of history. Again, right up till Force Awakens with the Raptors kind of recreating it too. Yeah, a great one. One for me, I think, is definitely when he's got the amulet, the Staff of Ra.
Yeah.
And, kind of the scene of the light shining through.
And that's the first time you get that bit of, science fiction supernatural.
That's the thing, it's a magical moment. You do get totally,
he's done
overwhelmed
it.
By it. Yeah, it seems like such a small thing.
Yeah.
The final puzzle piece to see where to dig and stuff like that. But it's just so beautifully and
really
emotionally swells up to that point.
Yeah.
It's great.
And the music, again, it just adds to it so much.
John Williams,
it's really high and, really, it's brilliant, that bit. I must admit, I love the bit where they take over the ship on the U-boat and then they're trying to look for Indiana Jones on the ship and he swam out across and he just climbs out the U-boat and he's like, see you guys.
That whole ship segment is really good. It's another one of my favourite moments I'd maybe pick up on. Just the sort of smaller character moment between Marion and Indy when Indy's, all beaten and battered and stuff like that too. But it's just such a sweet moment as well. And again, funny but touching and tells you learn about these characters' backstory.
Yeah.
And just a quiet moment in between so much of the big action. But it equally works. It works just as well as the big truck scene of a plane scene and stuff. Just the characters that by this point you do care for.
Yeah, really care for. Yeah, that's kind of the first time you see Marion and Indy show any kind of love towards each other. That's always sarcasm or anger or a bit of aggression towards them.
That's it, yeah. That's when the idea of that past relationship comes to the fore and you're like, oh, you can see how these characters
would have had a relationship. But then also it's probably one of the few times in the film that all the action kind of stops and they finally get a chance to relax and then there's just a bit of romance happening and he's out cold.
it works really so good. Well. Again, so much about this film. Again, from those quiet moments to the huge action pieces, it is just sort of flawlessly, beautifully, iconically put together, and it's clear why this film has had such a remaining legacy.
Definitely. I mean, we'll talk about a lot of films on here at the moment, all the time, because that's what we do, talk about films. But to say if a film is flawless is a very hard thing to do, and I think this really is one of the few films that you could say that about.
Yeah, that's the thing, everyone at the top of their game, a perfect choice for your first choice for our retro review series. So yeah, it was a joy rewatching it. If you haven't rewatched it in a while, again, it's been a few years for me.
Yeah, it's been quite a few years for me as well.
So, definitely just watching it from start to finish, not even, catching the last 20 minutes on TV, on Boxing Day or whatever, what I mean? It's one of the, where, kind of sat down and really focused on it. And it's as thrilling and enjoyable now as it was the first time I watched it when I was, however old I may have been. Yeah.
And at the same time, if you've got any thoughts, if you thought the film wasn't flawless, I would love to hear if anybody's got any criticisms of it, because I literally couldn't think of one.
If you do,
let us know, yeah, definitely.
What are your favourite moments, favourite characters? Again, what scenes stand out to you? We've got those cameos, we've got the, even C-3PO and R2, we've got hidden little moments in it as well. We'll be back soon to talk about the second film in the series, George Lucas's first foray in prequel territory, Temple of Doom. We'll get onto that one.
Is it a prequel?
Yeah, it's a prequel.
I didn't know.
That's
1929.
I think it's a few years before.
Whoa!
Yeah.
Mind
blown. Getting people ready for that. I remember this bomb. He was going to drop on you. But thanks again for watching. As always, do get in touch Twitter, Instagram, Facebook,
all over the place now.
We've had loads of people getting in touch, dropping their thoughts and stuff too. Obviously, the comment section below as well. Again, subscribe and drop us a message in there. We do always reply as well. Happy to do so.
We're getting
pretty good at this, this sort of thing. But as always, the support's totally appreciated. Again, any support you can, sharing, liking, again, getting in touch, it's all great to hear.
Yeah, thanks for watching.
But yeah, catch you soon. Bye.
Bye.